Again, we appreciate each one of you who have taken the time to be with us today. We're living in what seem to be troublous times. And if you haven't heard of the COVID-19 virus by now, you certainly have had your head, as it were, in the sand. And people are wondering now, they're starting to ask, you know, maybe we're starting to get on top of this, maybe we're getting an angle on this virus, how to deal with it, but what happens in the future? What's going to be the political and the civil new standards that are going to happen in the future? Well, let's just begin by assuming that this virus will indeed die down and be under control within the next few weeks to a few months. Gary Wagner of Fulcrum 7 has suggested that there are two possible outcomes. Number one, if the lockdowns, which he considers draconian, were deemed effective, they will become a precedent then for every future virus or bug scare that happens, because people are becoming more fearful. Or secondly, if the lockdowns are deemed ineffective, overzealous politicians will say, we should have done more. So in other words, it doesn't matter whether these means seem to be effective or ineffective, they can be used as an excuse to provide more stringent control in the future. Either way, we see a fear factor being built up in the people. Now, are these lockdown measures yet truly draconian? Well, that may depend upon how you define the term draconian. In California, they've asked, for example, non-essential personnel to stay home. They've only are giving certain categories of people that should be out, but they also said, but there's not going to be a fine. If they catch you out, they're not going to fine you or do anything, at least at this point. The government is trying to put together a financial relief stimulus package to help those who have been put out of work. Even President Trump claims he's having productive talks with Senator Schumer of New York concerning the financial situation in the nation. People are looking at these situations and they're coming to a lot of different ideas. Those of you who were here last week with us, you know, I was preaching about the COVID-19 virus and God's plan and dealing with these things. And so this week, someone who probably didn't see that message or didn't hear that message wrote me a question, are you having camp meeting yet? And that's a good question, because we haven't made a determination yet if we're going to be able to continue to have the camp meeting. We're planning a camp meeting, we've set a date for camp meeting, and we hope indeed that things will clear off in time to have a camp meeting. But we don't know yet. And so this kind individual just sent me the text, Psalms 91:10. I said, yes, well, this is true. And I said, but have you also considered Numbers chapter 5 and some other texts? And sent me back the text again, Psalms 91. No plague shall come nigh thy dwelling. And so, you know, the implication is, if you don't have your meeting, you don't have faith. And you can see how Satan can use this kind of a mindset to turn brother against brother even. When the Bible speaks of quarantining, the Bible speaks of social distancing, if you please. And that is a correct, biblical, healthful principle. So people are looking at these things from different perspectives. But there are clearly fears and anxieties and concerns about the near as well as the not too distant future of the nation and even the earth. On July the 20th of 1969, Neil Armstrong guided the lunar lander Eagle to what had been named the Sea of Tranquility. But some of the mathematical calculations that NASA did were wrong, and the Eagle was overshooting its landing site. Armstrong was running out of fuel and had to find another landing site amidst large boulders, craters, and the like. And though the procedures for landing the Eagle were not physically taxing, he had to take it off of the autopilot and he had to manually control the lander. And as he did so, his heart rate rose greatly. Here we have a graph of his heart rate as he was making his descent. And you see at about the time that they actually landed, his heart rate was 150 beats per minute. I don't know if you realize just how fast that is, but when I run as hard as I can on the treadmill, about the fastest I can get my heart to beat is about 150 beats per minute under the greatest exertion that I can put it. And Armstrong is probably just a little bit healthier at his 39 years old than I am at my almost 63. And yet his heart rate was running because of the anxiety and the taxation that he was mentally under at that time, emotionally under. Well, this danger that we're facing right now from COVID-19, and some people don't believe it's real, some people believe it's simply a manufacturing idea of the government and the medias, and that there really isn't so much death, there really isn't so much sickness, it's not so bad as people think. Well, I'll let you decide that for yourself. But there is a danger involved here, beloved, and most likely we are going to get past this initial phase of what's happening. We see in China, for instance, that in the provinces where this was most heavily affected, that it has indeed went down, and certainly we are doing no less here in America now with a little preemptive care to stop it. So we could expect in a month or less, or maybe 2 months, that we would see a similar decline in cases here. It was reported to me twice this week that we were going to have martial law the next day by seemingly good, reasonable sources. It didn't happen. But if we miss martial law now, how long before it truly does come? How long before fines, imprisonments, and other measures are brought upon people who don't cooperate? We're told in the book Great Controversy, for example, concerning the Sunday law. She says, and this is Great Controversy, page 607.1, as the movement for Sunday enforcement becomes more bold and decided, the law will be invoked against commandment keepers. They will be threatened with fines and imprisonment, and some will be offered positions of influence and other rewards and advantages as inducements to renounce their faith. And so it begins with fines, the threat of imprisonment. We know it will eventually end with a death decree. There will be some who will be induced to try to leave their faith because of financial advantages or worldly advantages. And this is going to happen. We can't say the exact time it's going to happen, but beloved, the signs of the times are telling us that these things are coming, and they're coming quickly. And I would say that amidst this sea of untranquility, we need to know how we can live today. With that in mind, I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 41, verses 8 through 10. Isaiah 41, verses 8 through 10. He says, "But thou, Israel, art my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, the seed of Abraham, my friend." Verse 9. "Thou whom I have taken from the ends of the earth, and called thee from the chief men thereof, and said unto thee, Thou art my servant. I have chosen thee, and not cast thee away." And now notice in verse 10. "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee, yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness." In verse 8, God says Israel is his servant. He calls him Jacob, whom he has chosen. Now remember that Jacob was the given or the character name of the second son of Isaac. And that name meant that he would be a cheater, a deceiver. But God accepted Jacob. God changed him and made him a prince. He made him Israel. And Jacob was the seed or the descendant of Abraham, who is called the friend of God. Now, it's interesting that the Hebrew word for friend here is ahabal. It is translated friend or friends 12 times in the Bible out of 210 times that this Hebrew word is used. It's usually translated love, loved, lovely. In fact, over half of the times, 124 of 210 times, is translated as such. It can mean friend. It can mean love or other similar things. But here, it's not in an adjective form of the word, as we would see it in English. It's like used as an adjective. But actually, in the Hebrew, it's a verb form of the word. And maybe that is why the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, uses the verb agapeo, which is the word for love in Greek, and would be translated instead, Jacob, the seed of Abraham whom I have loved. God is speaking here in compassionate terms. He brings up the name Jacob. In Psalms 40, you might want to keep your hand here in Isaiah 41, we'll be coming back to it frequently or making reference to it. But in Psalms chapter 20 and verse 1, he says, "The Lord hear thee in the day of trouble. The name of the God of Jacob defend thee." Now here, God uses the name Jacob. He didn't say the God of Israel. He couldn't. But he said the name of the God of Jacob. And he's using Jacob here because Jacob means a deceiver. He's a bad guy at this point. But God says, I will associate with those who need me. I will associate with the wicked, the vile, those who are in great need. I am their God. And if they will simply allow me to come into their lives, I will change them. I will take the deceiver and make him a prince. In Isaiah 41 and verse 9, God says that he has taken Israel from the ends of the earth, and he's called them from its farthest corners. God has left no stone unturned, beloved, to find his people and to draw close to them. God says Israel is his servant again, and he has chosen him. He has not cast him away. But I want to focus this morning especially on verse 10, where he says, "Fear thou not." God says to fear not. Outwardly, there was much at that time which the professed people of Israel could be afraid of in the day of Isaiah. The northern kingdom of Israel had been wiped out of existence by the mighty Assyrian army, and it appeared that Judah would not hold out much longer. The people were greatly in need of a message of comfort and hope and cheer, and Isaiah sought to inspire them with courage and cheer. Notice some of these verses in Isaiah chapter 40 and verses 1 and 2, for example. He says, comfort ye my people, saith your God. Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem, and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished, and that her iniquity is pardoned, for she hath received of the Lord's hand double for all her sins. Going back to Isaiah 41 in verse 13, he says, "For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, Fear not, I will help thee." In Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 5, he says, "Fear not, I am with thee. I will bring thy seed from the east and gather thee from the west." And in Isaiah chapter 44 and verse 2, "Thus saith the Lord that made thee and formed thee from the womb, which will help thee. Fear not, O Jacob, my servant, and thou, Jerusalem, whom I have chosen." And so God is telling us to fear not, to be of good cheer. Now, if I just tell someone, look, don't be afraid, they can say, well, you don't have any power to keep me from being afraid. And that's true, I don't. But may I remind you, as it says in Christ Object Lessons, that all his biddings are enablings. All his biddings are enablings. In other words, when God gives a command, there is power in the Word of God. The Word of God is powerful, Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12. And so in the Word of God, friends, we find the power to fulfill the very command because God's Word is creative. God said, let there be light, and there was light. When God speaks, power, action happens. And so when he speaks to us to fear not, friends, if we will simply be able to grasp by faith the promise, we need not be afraid. We need not fear for what is ahead. He says, fear thou not. This command in the Greek Septuagint is in what is called the imperative mode. It is an imperative command. You must not fear, he's telling us. And I will give you the ability not to fear. And then in Isaiah 41 and verse 10, God gives us five reasons why we should not fear. The first reason, he says, is, for I am with thee. He says, fear not, for I am with thee. In Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 14, it says, "Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." And what does that name Emmanuel mean? It means God with us. He would be with us. That is his promise, that he would be with his people. And this was desperately needed by Israel in the time of Isaiah. And I believe it's equally needed by us today. You know, as we think about our little group, and in one of the Sabbath school classes they were talking about the shaking, and how it seems like you start with a large group and it gets shaken down to a medium-sized group, and then to a small group and a smaller group, and you come down to a little flock at the end. And when we think about those people who are involved in this movement we call the Truth About God, or the One True God movement, whatever you wish to define it as, we are simply a small people. We have thousands, maybe a few thousands, maybe a few more. It's hard to know, but we have thousands, we believe. And they are seemingly scattered by the large church, where churches have millions. We have dollars and cents to work with. They have billions of dollars. It was recently revealed, as an example, that the South Pacific Division presidents, the South Pacific Division president of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, that his salary package is almost $250,000. $240,000, can you imagine that? And that's only for one administrator among many, let alone all the pastors and other workers that have to be paid. If we have God, friends, if we have God, however, nothing else matters if God is with us. He said, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee." When David went up against Goliath, if you had been there taking the wagers or the bets or placing the odds, almost no one would have chosen David. Goliath seemed to have all the advantages. He was strong, he was big, he had the army, he had the weapons. But David had the Lord with him. In Deuteronomy chapter 31, notice what we read here in verses 6 and 8. "The counsel of the Lord through Moses, be strong and of good courage. Fear not, nor be afraid of them. For the Lord thy God, he it is that doeth go with thee. He will not fail thee, nor forsake thee." And then in verse 8, "And the Lord, he it is that doeth go before thee. He will be with thee. He will not fail thee, neither forsake thee. Fear not, neither be dismayed." Beloved, God has never failed his people. God has never failed his people in times ancient and more times near, and he's not going to fail us now, and he's not going to fail us in the future. He says that he will hold on to us, as we read in Isaiah 41:13, that he will hold on to us with his right hand. And there's something important about holding on to someone's hand in a crisis. It speaks when words can't be verbalized. God will hold the hand of his people, and they will be reassured. In Deuteronomy chapter 20 and verse 1, he says, "When thou goest out to battle against thine enemies, and seest horses and chariots, and a people more than thou, be not afraid of them, for the Lord thy God is with thee, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt." He says, when you go out and you face that evangelical world, that pagan world, that apostate Protestant and Catholic world, don't be afraid. They have more people. They have means. They have the theologians. They have people who have the PhDs and the MAs and all those degrees. But friends, no matter what they have, that's equivalent to the horses and the chariots of that day. God is with us. God is with us. In Joshua chapter 1 and verse 9, the captain of the Lord's host says to Joshua, "Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest." And so here we have this great command to be strong, to be of good courage. To be of good courage means that you're not afraid. And he says, the reason you can do this is because the Lord of hosts is with you. Let's go to Jeremiah chapter 1. Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse 19. And remember, beloved, as we read these verses, There is power within the verse, power within the Word of God to fulfill that which it desires. Jeremiah 1:19, and it says, "And they shall fight against thee, but they shall not prevail against thee." Why? "For or because I am with thee, saith the Lord, to deliver thee." Beloved, we need not fear because God is with us. We need not fear because He is our God. Jehovah is our God. We do not serve the pagan, papal God of the heathen. We worship the God who created the heavens and the earth. In 1 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 6, we read this, "But to us there is but one God, the Father." Not one God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, but one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we in Him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by Him. In Exodus chapter 5 and verse 2, Pharaoh said, he asked the question, "Who is the Lord that I should obey His voice and let Israel go? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go." That's Exodus 5 verse 2. But the interesting thing is there, that when you look at the word Lord, it's all in capital letters. He wasn't just speaking of some Lord in general. I don't know who your Lord is. He knows that the name of the God of Israel is Jehovah. And he says, "Who is Jehovah that I should obey His voice? I don't know Jehovah." Friends, in this case, who had more at stake here, God or Moses? Who was going to speak and act for God in this matter? God Himself would take the lead. He would bring plagues upon Egypt to show Pharaoh who He was. Today, the theologians are saying, "Who is this only begotten Son? We will not acknowledge Him. We will worship the God of ecumenicalism. We will worship the God of Trinity." But friends, God says He will declare that He is our God, and He will be with us as He was with Moses during those plagues, and I think particularly the plague of the hail. Let's turn back to Exodus chapter 9 and read about that. Exodus chapter 9. We're going to start in verse 18. He says, "Behold, tomorrow about this time I will cause it to rain a very grievous hail, such as hath not been in Egypt since the foundation thereof, even until now. Send therefore now, and gather thy cattle, and all that thou hast in the fields, for upon every man and beast which shall be found in the field, and shall not be brought home, the hail shall come down upon them, and they shall die." Verse 20. "He that feared the word of the Lord among the servants of Pharaoh made his servants and his cattle flee into the houses. And he that regarded not the word of the Lord left his servants and his cattle in the field. And the Lord said unto Moses, Stretch forth thine hand toward heaven, and there may be hail in all the land of Egypt, upon man and upon beast, and upon every herb of the field throughout the land of Egypt. And Moses stretched forth his rod toward heaven, and the Lord sent thunder and hail, and fire ran along upon the ground, and the Lord rained hail upon the land of Egypt." And so this great hail came down, and it was terrible. And Pharaoh, in verse 27, says he called for Moses and Aaron and said unto them, "I have sinned this time. The Lord is righteous, and I and my people are wicked." And so he asked Moses to entreat the Lord for him, to entreat Jehovah for him. And because he says, this is enough. But Moses knew better. Moses knew this wasn't going to work. In verse 30, he says, "But as for thee and thy servants, I know that ye will not yet fear the Lord God." And it says there that in verse 33, "And Moses went out of the city from Pharaoh and spread abroad his hands unto the Lord, and the thunders and hail ceased, and the rain was not poured upon the earth." Somehow Moses had been sent for through all this plague of hail. Somehow messengers got to him alive, and he came to the palace. He said, "I know you're not done with this, but I'm going to do this anyhow for you." And so he says he walked out. Now, he didn't just ask for the hail to stop before he left the palace. He walked right out into the midst of the hail, beyond the palace, out of the city. So he'd be clearly seen that God was working and God was with him. And then he asked for the hail to stop, and it stop. In Patriarchs and Prophets on page 270, paragraph 2, we are told that Moses knew that the contest was not ended. Pharaoh's concessions and promises were not the effect of any radical change in his mind or heart, but were wrung from him by terror and anguish. Moses promised, however, to grant his request, for he would give him no occasion for further stubbornness. The prophet went forth, unheeding the fury of the tempest, and Pharaoh and all his hosts were witnesses to the power of Jehovah to preserve his messenger. Having passed without the city, Moses spread abroad his hands unto the Lord, and the thunders and hail ceased, and the rain was not poured upon the earth. But no sooner had the king recovered from his fears than his heart returned to its perversity. So Moses, he went out, and it says here that he went out amidst all the great tempest, and he could do that, friends, because God was with him. Going back to Isaiah chapter 41 and verse 10, he says, "Be not dismayed, for I am with thee." Now, this word, "be not dismayed," the Hebrew word translated dismayed is shata, and it literally means to gaze at, or in a sense, to view upon, but in the context and the way that this is said, it means to don't be afraid or to feel anxious. And so he's sort of repeating himself here to us. He says, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not don't be dismayed. Don't be astonished. Be calm, because you're not fearful, because I am with you." We need not fear because, friends, Jehovah is with us. Now, we as a people, we have a very special message, and we generally call it the three angels' messages, but there's another message, the name for this message that we use at times, and we sometimes call it based upon based upon Malachi, the Elijah message. It's the Elijah message. But if you think about the name Elijah literally means Jehovah is my God. So he is our God, and we who carry the Elijah message know that. The third point, he says, he will strengthen us. Jehovah will strengthen us. Let's turn to Isaiah chapter 12 and verse 2. He says, "Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid, for the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song. He has also become my salvation." So Jehovah is our strength. He is our salvation and our song. And when you think about the songs that the Hebrews sang, they just didn't sit around and sing silly songs. They sung songs of experience. The biblical songs are songs of experience. And when they say that the Lord Jehovah is my song, he's my strength and my song, that song is about our personal experience with him and how he has strengthened us, how he has helped us, how he has been with us. In Psalms 27 and verse 1, David speaking here, he says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" And so because the Lord is our strength, we need not be afraid. Now, David was a shepherd boy, and he speaks about facing a bear and a lion, and he also faced a giant. And he could say that he was not afraid because Jehovah was his strength. David had trusted in the Lord. He had tasted for himself and he saw that the Lord is good. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, in verses 34 through 37, David said unto Saul, "Thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear and took a lamb out of the flock. And I went out after him, and smote him, and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, I caught him by the beard, and smote him, and slew him. Thy servant slew both the lion and the bear. And this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he hath defied the armies of the living God." David said, "Moreover, the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine." And Saul said unto David, "Go, and the Lord be with thee." You know, it's interesting, when the animals came to rob the sheep, David fought them, but he didn't fight them because he was backed into a corner. and didn't have any opportunity to do otherwise. The reference indicates that the animals came and they tried to take the sheep away. And so it wasn't that David was confronted and startled in a way that he had to defend himself. He had to try to attack the lion or the bear to defend himself. No, rather, he went out after the lion. He went out after the bear to save the sheep. And this is what God does for us, friends. Here, the dragon has come in to try to destroy us. And he tries to carry us away. But God proactively attacks and says, no, you cannot. My strength will save them from destruction. In Psalms 18 and verse 2, he says, the Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler and the horn of my salvation and my high tower. A buckler was a type of shield. It was a small shield, a very mobile shield. But he says, he's my defense, he's my strength, he is my everything. Now, friends, it's true. Apart from Christ, we can do nothing. In John chapter 15, verse 5, Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. But we also know in Philippians chapter 4, and verse 13, that through Christ, we can do all things because he strengthens us. He strengthens us. He is our strength. I like this text in Romans chapter 5 and verse 6. If we could turn to Romans chapter 5 and verse 6. He says, for when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. We who have no strength, had no strength, Christ dies for us. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 9, Paul speaks about his strength coming from the Lord through his weakness. He had this infirmity. We are told it was blindness. Paul was going blind. And he besought the Lord three times that he could be relieved of this malady, this problem. And in verse 9 of chapter 12, and he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. And so because of that, Paul says, most gladly therefore will I rather glory my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. And so we have no strength of ourselves, but he says his strength, his power, is made perfect in our weakness. And so, friends, it's okay to know and to realize, hey, I can't do this. I don't have strength. I don't have power. Lord, you're asking me to face something. I can't do it. Exactly. Exactly. Get to the point. Understand that, and you've got the bigger part of it already made then. Because when you understand you can't do it, when you understand there's no hope of you doing it, then you put your whole dependence upon the Lord's strong arm, who is strong and mighty and able to save us to the uttermost. And then you get your strength that you do need for your task. He says that we need not fear because, yea, he will help us. He doesn't just simply say he will help us. He says, yes, I will help you. He's emphatic about this. He will help us. Let's look at Isaiah 49 and verse 8. Thus saith the Lord, in an acceptable time have I heard thee, and in a day of salvation have I helped thee. And I will preserve thee and give thee for a covenant of the people to establish the earth, to cause to inherit the desolate heritages. Now, this verse may sound a little familiar to you. It's because the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 2 quotes this verse. But if you look at this verse in the New Testament, if you look at the Greek equivalent in the Septuagint, you'll notice that there is a word that's used in it. It's boetho. Boetho. And boetho is used here for the word help. It is from two Greek words, boi, meaning a cry, and theo, meaning to run to. And so it means to run to the cry, you're running to give aid to those who are crying out. And God says, as it were here, you're in need, you have trouble, I'm running to your aid. We see examples of this in the Bible. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, we read there about the problem that the king of Syria was having with the king of Israel. Every time he would try to do something, the king of Israel was given notice ahead of time by Elisha the prophet. And the king of Syria, he thought that there was a spy infiltrated in his group, that Israel had a spy and someone was there learning the king's plans and then relating it to the king of Israel so the king of Israel could be ready. And finally, one of his men at court understood the problem, and he said, "That's not the problem, Cain." He says, "It is the prophet Elisha. He sees everything that's going on. He knows what you're doing," and he's relating it to the king of Israel. And so the king of Syria says, "Okay, we'll take care of him." So he learns where the prophet Elisha is, and he sends, and that was at Dothan, and he sends his army to surround the city. Well, the prophet, his servant, sees. Well, let's just read. He sees what's happening, and let's read about it. In 2 Kings chapter 6, we'll start in verse 14. It says, "Therefore sent he," that is the king of Syria, "thither horses and chariots and a great host, and they came by night and encompassed the city about." That was the city of Dothan, verse 15. "And when the servant of the man of God was risen early and gone forth, behold, an host encompassed the city, both with horses and chariots. And his servant said unto him, 'Alas, my master, how shall we do?'" Verse 16. "And he said, 'Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them.' And Elisha prayed and said, 'Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes, that he may see.' And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. And when he came down to him, Elisha prayed unto the Lord and said, 'Smite this people, I pray thee, with blindness.' And he smote them with blindness according to the word of Elisha." You know, if we'd been there, I don't know how we would have prayed. Would we have prayed differently? Maybe we would have prayed for the Lord to send the Egyptians to come and help us, or for some other great means of help. And God's servant here, no doubt under inspiration, simply asked for something very simple. And as soon as he asks, God answers his call. There's a story in chapter 4 of 2 Kings about this widow of a prophet and how she was indebted. We could read it here in 2 Kings chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. "Now there cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets unto Elisha, saying, 'Thy servant, my husband, is dead. And thou knowest that thy servant did fear the Lord, and the creditor is come to take unto him my two sons to be bondsmen.' And Elisha said unto her, 'What shall I do for thee? Tell me, what hast thou in thy house?' And she said, 'Thine handmaid hath not anything in the house save a pot of oil.' And he said, 'Go borrow thee vessels abroad of all thy neighbors, even empty vessels, borrow not a few. And when thou art come in, thou shalt shut the door upon thee and upon thy sons, and thou shalt pour out into all those vessels, and thou shalt set aside that which is full.' And so she went from him and shut the door upon her and upon her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured out. And it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said unto her son, 'Bring me yet a vessel.' And he said unto her, 'There is not a vessel more,' and the oil stayed. Then she came and told the man of God, and he said, 'Go sell the oil, pay thy debt, and live thou and thy children of the rest.'" God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble, Psalms 46 and verse 1. To say God is a help means that he is a helper. And he is a help to all those who are in need, and he brings help. Our fifth point, he says, "Yea, he will uphold us with the right hand of his righteousness," or "he will uphold us with his righteous right hand." References to the right hand in Scripture not only refer literally to the person's dominant hand, but also metaphorically to prominence and strength. In patriarchal times, the blessing referred to, given by the father to the child, was always given with the right hand. To speak of someone's right hand was to speak of their power. For example, in Psalms 20 and verse 6, "Now know I that the Lord saveth his anointed. He will hear him from his holy haven with the saving strength of his right hand." And we could look at several other verses along this way. An oath was accompanied by raising the right hand. Isaiah 62 and verse 8. He says, "The Lord has sworn by his right hand and by the arm of his strength, surely I will no more give thy corn to be meat for thy enemies, and the sons of thy strangers shall not drink thy wine, for the which thou hast labored. And so he says he swears by his right hand and by his uplifted strong arm. And also, if you remember in Revelation chapter 10, this angel lifts up his right hand and swears by him that lives forever and ever. To sit at someone's right hand was to sit at a place of honor. In Psalms 110 and verse 1, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou where? At my right hand until I make thine enemy thy footstool. This is referenced also in Acts 2:33 and Hebrews 1:3. And there are several references when Stephen was, just before he was stoned, he said, I see the Lord Jesus. He's sitting at the right hand of the Father. And when Jesus returns, according to the parable of Matthew chapter 25, he will place the believers on his right side. But not simply with a favored right hand does God deal with us, but also with a righteous right hand. He is fully righteous, and as we become like him, we are transformed into his likeness and the character of his righteousness. The Bible says in Romans chapter 3, verse 26, that he is just and the justifier of him that believeth in Jesus. He is just, he is righteous in all that he does. His law, which is a transcript of his character, is holy, just, and good. And so his righteous right arm and right hand defend us and lift us up. The Hebrew word translated righteous in Isaiah 41:10 is tzedek, from which we get our word tzedak, as used in Daniel 8:14 for cleanse. It is this word that just means so much, it has so many nuances of meaning and appreciation to us. And so friends, we need not fear because Jehovah is with us. We need not fear because he is our God. We need not fear because he will strengthen us. We need not fear, yea, he will help us, and yea, he will uphold us with his righteous right hand. In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 18, John says, there is no fear in love. There is no fear in love. And so friends, if we do not fear, God says, fear thou not, that means that we are understanding, accepting, and receiving God's love, because it is God's love that casts this fear out. It says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. His love in our lives casts out all fears. The Greek word we translate fear here is phobia. Actually, phobia is in the Greek, from which we get our word phobia. And this love that casts out fear is found, according to verses 9 and 10 of this chapter, in the gift of God's Son to us. In Psalms 34 and verse 4, he says, I sought the Lord, and he heard me and delivered me from most of my fears. Does it say that? It doesn't say from most of my fears, does it? Let me read that again. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from A-L-L, all my fears. And so God is able to do this for us. David said that he had fears, but he sought the Lord, and the Lord delivered him, and God helped him with his perfect love, and he will help us too. I found a little gem I wanted to share with you. This was from Charles Spurgeon, part of a devotional book he put together. But the title of this is called A Wonderful Guarantee, and it will be our next to last slide. The text he uses is, I will strengthen thee. When called to serve or to suffer, we take stock of our strength, and we find it to be less than we thought and less than we need. But let not our hearts sink within us while we have such a word as this to fall back upon, for it guarantees us all that we can possibly need. God has strength omnipotent. That strength he can communicate to us, and his promise is that he will do so. He will be the food of our souls and the health of our hearts, and thus he will give us strength. There is no telling how much power God can put into a man when divine strength comes. Human weakness is no more a hindrance. Do we not remember seasons of labor and trial in which we received such special strength that we wondered at ourselves? In the midst of danger, we were calm. Under bereavement, we were resigned. In slander, we were self-contained. And in sickness, we were patient. The fact is that God gives unexpected strength when unusual trials come upon us. We rise out of our feeble selves. Cowards play the man. Foolish ones have wisdom given them, and the silent receive in the self-same hour what they shall speak. My weakness makes me shrink, but God's promise makes me brave. Lord, strengthen me according to thy word. That's from Charles Spurgeon's devotional book, Faith's Checkbook, the reading for January the 5th. But in the beginning of this last paragraph, he says, you know, don't you remember times when things happened, and as you look back now, you see how God supplied a special measure of grace and help for you. And it reminds me of that statement in Life Sketches, I believe, on page 220, where Ellen White says that we have nothing to fear for the future, except as we shall forget the way the Lord has led us and his teachings in our past history. And I know we emphasize that last part, his teachings in our past history, but also as he has led us. And that's not only as a people, but we can apply that as our individuals. We can see times when we were truly in the midst of the danger, but we were calm. We recall times under bereavement that we were resigned. We recall times when, yes, we were slandered, but we were self-contained. We recall times of sickness when we were patient. I want to assure everyone who's listening to us today that we are praying for all those who are affected not only by the coronavirus, but from all the needs and issues and burdens that you have in your life that cause you to be tempted, to be fearful, and to be anxious at this time. There are people, as we had in our earlier prayer requests, people who are struggling with cancer, people who are struggling with heart disease, people who are struggling financially right now, who need work, who need livelihoods. We're praying for you, friends, and we're praying for your specific needs where we can. And please let us know, though, that if there are things that we can do other than prayer to help, because this is one of the ways that God has given us to try to see that the prayers are answered, to do all within our part to help. Maybe someone needs a ride somewhere. I can't maybe come give someone in Kansas a ride or take them to the store, but maybe we know someone who can. We can connect you or network you with someone at this time to be of a help to you. But we want to be of a help to you in any way we can. We cannot always do a lot, friends, but here's the good news. God can. God can strengthen us. He will help us. He will save us. And as I think of the words of Jesus in Luke chapter 12 and verse 32, he said, "Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." And so thinking back again about that, the idea of the shaking and the sifting and coming down to a little flock, but he says to his little flock, "Fear not." He says, "Fear not, because it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." Even in this world, if we perish, if tomorrow I contract the coronavirus and I die, God has promised to give me part of the kingdom, that I can be an heir to the kingdom. And that is ultimately what is important. And so, yes, we want health and welfare in this life. 3 John chapter 1, verse 2 is just the one chapter. He says, "Beloved, you know, I wish above all things that thou prosperest and be in health, even as thy soul prospers." So God wants us to have good health. He wants us to be strong. We need to, as we said last week, everything we can within our power to follow the 8 natural remedies, to follow principles of cleanliness and health, and even quarantining where necessary, i.e. social distancing. But God has promised to be with us, and he's promised to be a help to us, and he's going to be a help to you too. And if you will just fear not, because he has promised it. If you will accept the promise of God, we can face the days, the weeks, and the months that may be ahead with courage and strength. And may God bless each one of you lots and lots and lots.